Listening Library presents The Rules by Nancy Holder and Debbie Viguie. Read for you by Robbie Daymond. Everyone has rules. The rules they play by, the rules they live by. Here are your rules. Don't run. Don't scream. Play the game. Break the rules, and you die. Prologue. The New Rules According to Robin Brisset. New Rule Number 1. Keep running. Flames raged along the cliff. Pine trees and manzanita bushes ignited with a whirlwind whoosh. The steam rising off Robin's sopping wet jeans as she zigzagged toward the beach like a desperate rabbit inches ahead of the fire. Salt and embers clogged the air. Her tongue was blistering, her lungs burning. The hitch in her side ached as if she were being smacked over and over with a baseball bat. Everything stung and burned. She really, really had to stop. Ringlets of her rich red hair dangled in her eyes as the blood dripped off the tips. She couldn't see, and she batted at the crazy corkscrews that insisted on bouncing right back. She was still stunned from crashing into the shell wall, lurching drunkenly left and right, fighting her hair, her exhaustion, and her panic. If she stopped running, she would die. New Rule Number 2. Never surrender. Robin's family had sworn not to let her dad's accident break them. The hit and run had shattered their dreams, crushed their plans, just like his spine. It doesn't matter, her mom said. It's up to us. No one's going to come to our rescue. We are defined by how we react to setbacks. New Rule Number 3. People you know kill other people you know. Setbacks send some people on murderous rampages. No one's coming, no one's coming, no one's coming, Robin thought as a large pine limb split off a tree trunk, plummeting to the ground inches in front of her. She leaped over it, the heat singeing the bottoms of her boots. But that wasn't true. The killer was coming. Robin might be limping, gasping, but Robin was still running, and she would not surrender. Because if she did, someone she knew would kill her. Chapter 1. August in the Cemetery. 14 hours earlier. August's Rule Number 1. Don't get caught. Augusta Young and his sister, Alexa, who had been barely 1 year older than he, had grown up with just one rule. Don't get caught. Some kids grew up with parents who cared and paid attention. Others had parents who handed down so many rules it was impossible to keep them straight. All August and his sister had learned from their parents was to steer clear of blame. Their last name gave them a free pass. Money smoothed out situations. Use both to get out of trouble. That was how the rule worked. Until it didn't. Almost 3 years earlier, back in New York, Alexa had broken the rule, resulting in expulsion, addiction, and a serious breakdown. So their mother and father had yanked August and Alexa out of private school and rehab, respectively, and moved to Callabrese, California, a town so tiny that it shared a country club with three other agricultural pit stops, also stinking of manure. Although they opened a fine dining restaurant called DeYoung's, they hired staff to run it. Just as they hired staff to raise their children while they spent 90% of their time back in New York. Alexa tried so hard, but she got caught in the worst way possible. She had died exactly 1 year ago today, and their parents managed to disapprove even of that. August couldn't remember if they had cried at her funeral. He stood in front of her crypt, wondering if it would be for the last time. Set on a grassy hill overlooking the San Francisco Bay, the DeYoung tomb looked like a little marble Roman villa, an 8-foot-tall rectangle topped with an angled tiled roof. 4 fluted columns anchored the corners, and a sad marble angel drooped on top of each one. The door was black as death, and the brass fittings gleamed like halos. The little villa had cost the equivalent of a year's tuition at Harvard, which Alexa had been expected to attend. But the crypt was a bargain, really, because there was room for a dozen more dead de Youngs inside it. They hadn't buried Alexa in New York or Calabrese. San Francisco was a good address as cemeteries went, and it helped them keep the whole mess quiet. August was fiercely glad that Lex was finally out of Calabrese, which was nothing but grapevines and torment. Their parents had dumped them in a hellhole. That horrible, hopeless town had killed his sister, and it had been the people she knew, her friends. They had betrayed her. He remembered Alexa from the good days, when her light blonde hair had glittered and her skin had not been sallow, and whenever you looked at her, she was smiling in a way that made you smile, tiny and mischievous, like a little mouse. That was the Alexa he missed. But the one he mourned had been nothing like that. Dull eyes, hair of straw, scary thin. No mischief. The trap had sprung on the little mouse. Once the tomb had been completed, about a month after her murder, August had started driving to San Francisco every Saturday morning in his new Porsche. His parents had bought him the car in the hopes of cheering him up. That was their answer to everything. More possessions, more stuff. It took about an hour to get there. He would buy a bouquet of miniature roses wrapped in tissue paper at Fisherman's Wharf. He and Alexa used to ditch school and cruise the wharf, eating cracked crab on sourdough bread and guzzling Anchor Steam beer, even though they were underage. They'd feed the seagulls and talk about moving to San Francisco once they could leave without being reported as runaways. Lex begged August to just blow it all off and bail out of Calabrese, not to wait any longer. She couldn't bear it. She said their parents would never report them because of all the hassle it would cause. He wished to God he'd listened to her. They used to get their pictures taken in the photo booth and go to the wax museum and send each other on little scavenger hunts all over San Francisco. He didn't know how many times she had made him find the Yoda statue in the Presidio or pick up something with a sea lion on it. He still had her sea lion collection. That was how the scavenger hunt tradition had been born. Just for fun. Just to be goofy. Until August got his driver's license. Lex never learned to drive because she was afraid of cars. They hitchhiked to San Francisco and zoomed all over the city via cable cars and taxis. Alexa causing scenes, leaping into fountains and singing "What Does the Fox Say?" at the top of her lungs in the lobbies of all the exclusive hotels. August trailing behind, handing out money with his apologies, smoothing it over. She wasn't hurting anybody. Not when she was with him. But back in Calabrese, the fun faded quickly. She got into the kind of trouble that money could not fix, and her friends just made it worse. Her friends. She had never had friends in Calabrese. She had users, the so-called cool of the school, taking her down after they watched her flail for a few months to gain their acceptance. She didn't see that at first she scared them, and then they got off on letting her think they'd given her a place among them, when really, it was just to wind her up and watch her spin. He learned by example. When she died, he did not have one single friend at their school. Correction, not one single betrayer. God, he hated them. "You're getting payback, Lex," August promised her, his fingers closing around the bouquet that dangled at his side. "Tonight." And to execute it, he had a better weapon than knives or guns, an IQ of 160, which made him a certifiable genius. After what had happened to Alexa, he was certifiable, all right. He'd spent hours planning his revenge, and it would be sweet. And they didn't even have a clue that he was using them, manipulating them. Every smile he had flashed, every joke he had laughed at, all lies to throw them off the scent. All a part of his big scheme. After tonight, they would know exactly what he thought. But truthfully, Realizing he was about to cross that line scared and saddened him as much as the horrible police visit he'd received 1 year ago this very night. It had been 3 a.m. His parents were in Manhattan as usual, so it had been just him and Alexa. Two feral children raising each other because their parents couldn't be bothered. Only Alexa hadn't been home. She wasn't asleep in her room, as August had assumed. She'd snuck out, not because she had been wild like everybody would say later. She just wanted to go to a party.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.